Okay, another important thing, a sore area for a lot of us is that my parents are overprotective. I recall many years back, one of my son, he was having a very difficult time in school. First, I let him handle it, but obviously, kids are kid, he was not able to handle. He was in like 7th grade. One day I went to the school and I talked to the principal that his teacher is giving him very hard time and I wanted him to actually look into the matter. So this principal, he looked at me and he said, "Ma'am, aren't you a very overprotective mom?" I said, "Excuse me, what do you expect? This teacher is making my kid stand the whole day. My son is a very polite kind of a kid. He's excelling in his studies and everything, but he cannot speak up in front of the teacher out of respect. So you are misusing your authority over there, and I will be overprotective where my kids need me, or where I feel that their self-esteem is suffering, or where I feel they're in trouble and they need me, even if they don't see the need of it, but I'm going to be there for them." So that's how the parents are. You have to see, do you feel that your parents are controlling you? There are two options. They don't trust you, or they care about you more than anything. So this is the analysis that you need to have for yourself. Obviously, if you want them to let you go somewhere, are you being honest? Like, you have to actually ask yourself, are you being honest? They don't want you to hang out with guys, so are you making sure you're not hanging out with guys? If they are giving you phone and saying, okay, you can keep this phone, but you have to minimize your use. So if the phone is actually with you 24/7, are you minimizing the use? Are you using it like for only 3 hours and not peeking into it every few minutes? Similarly, you know, if they're letting you go shopping on your own and buying dresses on your own, are you buying modest dresses? Like, these are all the questions that you need to ask yourself, that why do they want to be with me all the time? Second is, they definitely care about you and they would definitely want to protect you. Like, again, I remember a long time back, one of my son, he wanted to go and visit some of his friend's house. And he said to me that, you know, we will be going to the marketplace and there is a gaming place and we will go and play games over there. So I said, are you going to be escorted by, you know, somebody, some elder? And he said, well, I don't know. So I called that boy's mom and I asked her, who is going to be escorting these kids? And that lady said, oh, they are grown-up kids, they will manage on their own. And I was like, excuse me, they're just 14, 15-year-old kids. What if there is someone offering them drugs? There's some sort of a fight over there and these kids are so young, someone bullies them. How would they take a stand for themselves? So they need to be supervised at that age. I'm concerned about him. I care about him. I don't want to see him in trouble. Like, every day we hear such horrific stories. Okay, then they make a lot of rules and they want to know everything. That's part of their being protective and that's what they do. So don't get too hung up about parental rules. You have to take it easy. I was talking to this expert and this expert was telling me one thing that really helps kids enjoy their relationship with their parents is acceptance. Acceptance of this hierarchy. Acceptance of this relationship with the parents, that the parents are going to have rules, parents are going to be overprotective, parents will be embarrassing, parents are going to force us to do certain things. And said, the moment you accept that, that's when you start enjoying this relationship. And there is so much fun in it, so much understanding in it. Like, you start investing in this relationship. You have to check out which of the statement is true about your parent. They always have to know exactly where I have been and whom I have been with. Some of the parents are like that. Then they have set a strict curfew for me. How much I succumb to my parents, they want me to change everything. One thing that we have to understand is we can't change our true nature. We have to live by our fitra. We all have different temperaments, different nature, different thought processes. That is okay. But you have to sift out where there are haram elements, where you have defiance in you have to change it. Where there is anything which is harmful for you from your parents' perspective, that needs to be addressed and changed. I can't mold my personality totally according to my parents. Okay, what you can do is whenever you have any challenge with your parents, you write down the challenge, then you can Google it, you can read it, that whatever my parents are expecting me to do, is it right or wrong? Also remember that if it is related to, for example, boys, because a lot of books and a lot of material will tell you, okay, fine, you can hang out with guys. But we also have to see from the Islamic perspective what guidelines we have been given. And that's where we need to definitely put a stop over there. Molding the personality means that you have to work around protecting yourself from the wrong principles. And that's what is important. You want to have fried or boiled egg in the morning and they want you to eat omelette. Well, that's where I would say, go ahead, you can have your omelette. Or they tell you to wear a pink dress or a red dress or something like that. But if they tell you this is immodest dress, you have to change it no matter how much you like it. If you are sharing memes which are dirty, I wouldn't like it either for my students or for my kids. Even if from your friend's perspective or the kind of circle you're hanging out with is cool. So that means you need to work on your friends. You have to have a reality check related to the friends. If you're hanging out with that crowd who are enjoying those dirty, sick memes, then you are in trouble and you will be heading for more trouble. So the sense of humor has to be very decent, something that you enjoy, something that is acceptable for everyone. So I think your mom is right over there. I wouldn't expect you to do something or get engaged in an activity which is dirty, which is not good. Okay, let's move on with the session. They have a set rule. They always rescue me when I get in trouble. Okay, they're judgmental about the friends I hang out with. That's also sometimes a challenge that we have. If I mess up, they put additional restrictions on me. They are nosy and they don't respect my privacy. They are overly strict and they have too many rules. If you are going through this kind of a scenario, let's try to understand the curfews. Parents like them, you don't like them. Most of the teens, they have curfews, even if they won't admit it. Mere kisi friend ke parents nahi rokte, aap rokti hain. When I'm taking a class somewhere and I am asking all my students, do your parents have a curfew line? Do your parents are strict about something? Do they refuse you some of the thing? Most of the girls, they raise their hands on one thing or the other. Even right now, if I ask you, aapke parents aapko rokte hain ke nahi rokte? Yes or no? I mean, I'm not asking on what area, but do this stop you telling you this is a line where that you have to draw and you can't go beyond this line? See, aap sabka jawab yes aayega. If you're not getting permission to go somewhere and you're telling your friends and your friends say, oh, hame to permission mil jati hai, to main pata nahi kyun nahi milti. Your parents, you know, they're too strict. But excuse me, okay, in one place your parents are letting you go somewhere, but in another area there are going to be kids who will not be getting those permissions. So ye to sabke saath hoga ki kisi area mein ek ko permission mil rahi hai, kisi area mein dusre ko permission mil rahi hai. That's something that we have to accept. The myth is, curfews were invented to ruin my life. The reality is, parents, they are worried about drugs, worried about psychos, illegal and haram stuff. And they're justified in that. I can give you 100 examples of the kids when parents let them do something, like even having a phone, even making Instagram, Twitter, and TikTok accounts and Snapchat accounts, even letting them be in co-ed in a certain institution, letting them go to academies like in Pakistan, and they messed up. There are very few percentage of kids who would say, my parents, they did not worry and they let me be on my own and everything turned out right in my life. The moment your parents would tell you to do not do a certain thing or do it in a certain way, if you don't follow it, you do definitely have some mess in your life. That's for sure. So curfews, they can get you out of uncomfortable situations as well. Like sometimes, you know, someone is inviting you and there's such a peer pressure on you, and you don't want to actually go. You know what kind of activities will be over there. So all you have to say is, my mom doesn't allow me. If I was allowed only, then I would go, but I'm so sorry. So you can always sneak out of that situation. But let's say there is a curfew and you want to negotiate, what you have to do is do something big for the parents. Like, be a good achiever in your studies, in your religion. Do something so good that they don't have to actually put up a big curfew for you. Secondly, you need to show that you are responsible by obeying that curfew and you build your reservoir of trust. Let's say if parents told you that you can't go somewhere, okay, you are upset about it, but you accept it and your parents see you accepting and respecting the boundaries they set. That is going to give your parents second thoughts that maybe next time I could let her go to a certain place. If not this kind of permission, but another kind of safe area permission would be there for you. But if you retaliate, if you show attitude, if you have a lot of that relationship bank account withdrawals, well, you will always be from one curfew to another curfew, or a constant state of curfew. The trust is not going to be there. Then if you have something big coming up, let your parents know in advance, and then you can make certain compromises. But again, having said that, the choice is still going to be with your parents. And parents will always look at your track record. Let's say you're doing hopeless in your studies. You always are fighting over the screen time. You always are giving them attitude over your hijab or going to places or being with the friends or whatsoever. Do you think your parents will let you go there? No matter how desperate you are? No, they will not. So you have to prove your worth to get those permissions. With some of the kids, now we have another big challenge. That is the parents who are always fighting. There's a dysfunctional family. All your challenges are going to be multiplied because you have your own challenges with the parents. The parents have challenges between themselves as well. Now, some kids, they live in this kind of war zone. And in such situation, only thing you can control is your own self. So you learn to be pleasant. You need to be peacemaker, because sometimes what the kids do is if they see their parents in conflict, they use them for their benefit. Amma abba lad rahe hain, chalo hum aise karte hain, is baat ki permission isse lete hain, us baat ki permission usse lete hain. So this is something you should never do. You should make your utmost effort to bring them together as parents. And remember this very beautiful verse from Surah Al-Isra, verse number 23, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَدَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Your Rabb has decreed upon you to worship none but Him. It is like a commandment that has been given to us. And be kind to your parents. So after the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the right of the parents. إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ كِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ وَلَا تَنْحَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. So if you find one of them or both of them in their old age, so what do? You do not even say a word of oof to them, a word of contempt to them, not even a body language, not even the rolling of the eyes, not even like, you know, any attitude, not even thinking, having this thought, very stingy thoughts related to your parents in your heart. وَلَا تَنْحَرْهُمَا. And you cannot be loud with them. You cannot repel them. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. And you have to talk to them and address them in a very, very beautiful manner, very humble manner. We have so many stories in which somebody would come up to the Prophet ﷺ and say, I have become a Muslim and my parent is not a Muslim and my mother curses me and she's not even kind to me. And what am I supposed to do for her? And the Prophet ﷺ said, go back and serve her, except for the deen. That is where you keep maintaining your identity. But other than that, you have to serve your parents. A man said, Messenger of Allah, what rights can parents demand for their children? And he replied, they are your paradise and they are your hell. In this verse, we had a very beautiful dua, which was also narrated. Rabbirhamhuma kama rabbayani saghira. O my Rabb, have mercy upon them as they brought me up when I was small. Like now that we are young, now that we are same height or even taller than our parents, now when we can look up in their eyes, and that's when, you know, we have this rebellious attitude. We need to have a very strong reality check over here. They had been so merciful towards us. They had been getting up late night for us. They are the only one who have been actually worried about us when we are sick. Even now, your mom, your dad might be so angry and mad at you and you get sick and they'd be rushing you to the hospital. They are saving all the time, all their money for you. We are the one who are always putting up our demands. Ye chahiye, ye chahiye, ye chahiye. I need this and I need that. And you look at these people, they have so much with them. And then, you know, we give them these threats. Okay, fine. I'll do some odd job and I'll make my own money. Once I'm out of this house, I'll do what I want to do. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't like that attitude. He wants us to make this dua and remember all those times. This is like something we need to remember. That, you know, our parents, they have done so much for us. Even now, you know, they are ready to do anything and everything for us where we actually need them. When other people are going to just say tata, bye-bye, and they will disappear from our life. They will leave us with troubles. You are with drugs. You are with a haram relationship. I have seen girls getting pregnant into depression. And the parents, they're spending so much money, rushing them to experts, and the girls, what they're doing over there, sitting and saying, oh, I'm not going to change. I'm not going to do anything. And the parents, they are not able to sleep at night because they're so worried for their daughters and their sons. They're crying their heart out. They are in sajda. They are constantly praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are just loaded with complaints. So this is a reality check we need to have. You know, our parents, they are our best well-wishers. Nobody is going to make du'as for us like our parents do. And remember this thing. We don't cherish them in our life. Once they're not there, then we'll be living with regrets. And I was reading the story of one of the sahabi, one of the companion, and his mom was a widow and she received a proposal. Her mom actually went to her son and said, I'm receiving this proposal, so you arrange for my marriage. Subhanallah. This is the kind of relationship they had, the mothers and the sons or the kids. And I was thinking that we're living in those times when we're so self-centered, we only think about ourselves. We never think about the challenges of our parents, the health challenges, the emotional challenges, the regrets they have, how we abuse them, how we break their heart, how much we taunt them, how much we scold them. So these are the things that needs to be addressed, especially remembering this dua. We'll finish off over here, but we are not actually done with the topic. Inshallah, tomorrow we'll be talking about how we can bridge up the gap that or the damage that has already been done, how from our perspective we can work around it. So what I want you to do is today, I want you to analyze all these aspects that we have talked about, okay? Definitely make this dua for your parents. And when you make this dua, you can actually go back and forth on whatever they do for you. And remember, you know, this is ultimately going to bring back that energy and sweetness in this relationship. Get such a beautiful bonding with your parents. I love making this dua for my own parents. رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّا كَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ وَتُوبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّا كَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ وَبِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ السَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ